press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.
Hello my dear students, in the previous class we learnt about the types of fabrics. Based on the types of fabrics, fabrics can be classified into different types according to the fibers. First one is natural fabrics. These are the fabrics which are obtained from the natural fiber, like from the plant source as well as from the animal source. Plant source and the animal source. See, from the plant source we get the wool and cotton and the jute are the plant source, whereas from animal source wool and the silk is the animal source. In the previous class we learnt about the cotton and the jute. Cotton is a fluffy ball. During the flowering stage it will be converted into the ball, and that is nothing but the cotton ball. And this cotton ball, we seen the fiber inside this cotton ball, and in which lots of seeds will be there, and these seeds covered with a fiber known as cotton fiber. And also we learnt about the process known as ginning. This process is removal of seeds from the cotton mass, and this process is known as ginning. There is one instrument is there, that one is a large steel comb. By using this instrument, fiber can be removed from the cotton, from the seeds, by combing. This process is known as ginning. And next one is jute. See, plant source include cotton and jute, wool and silk. See, next one is jute. Jute is obtained from the plant known as patsen. From this plant, we must take the stem of this plant. At the flowering stage, people harvest this plant and keep this stem into the water, so that the stem will become rotten. Later, it can be easily removed the stem from the fiber. See, this process is known as retting. Jute producing in countries are India, Thailand and the Bangladesh. These are the main jute producing countries in the world. In India, jute is produced in Delta region near the river Ganga and the Brahmaputra. This is all about the jute fiber. Next one is wool. Wool is obtained from the fleece of wool yielding animals like sheep, goat, camel, rabbit. These are the wool yielding animals. We get this wool from these animals. Wool retain air which is trapped inside the wool, and this air will helpful for maintain the fiber. It will become the fluffy in nature, and it also trap the body temperature, means it will maintain our body temperature. That's why people during the rainy season or winter season usually wear this cloth. See, there is one process is comes under this heading, that is the wool. See, shearing. The process of removal of fleece along with the skin is known as shearing. Next we shall move on to the silk. Silk is a natural fiber which is obtained from the plant animal source. See, silk is a animal source which obtained from the animal. Silk is commonly called as resham. Resham in Hindi and reshme in Kannada. See, these silk are the protein fiber. Which are obtained by the cocoon. It is a outer covering of the silkworm. Silkworm made this cocoon by keeping in one place and reeling or silk thread will produce. And this is nothing but the cocoon. See, silk is a animal source which obtained from the animal fiber, and this fiber includes it is also called as resham in Hindi and silk in Kannada, silk in English, and in Kannada it is also called as reshme. See, it is a protein fiber and which is made by the cocoon. It is a stage of a silkworm. See, life history of silkworm later I will tell you. It is a made by the silkworm. It is a protective covering. See, this cocoon means what? Protective covering, which is made by the silkworm. See, next we shall move on to the life cycle of silkworm. See, before going to the life cycle of silkworm, there is one process is comes in this heading, and that process is known as sericulture. See, what is the meaning of sericulture? Sericulture means the rearing of silkworm to obtain the silk is called as sericulture. See, the process of rearing nothing but the sakodu. The process of rearing of silkworm to obtain silk is called as sericulture. See, by this process we can collect the silk, or we drag out the silk from the silkworm. Silkworm nothing but the worm, reshme hula. See, by using the silkworm we drag out the silk from the silkworm, and the process will be like this. See, this is the mulberry plant and the mulberry leaf. The plant where the mulberry leaves are there, and this is known as mulberry leaves. Usually, this silkworm lays egg in the mulberry leaves. See, hundreds of eggs are laid by the silkworm. See, afterwards, there is a larva stage is there. Larva stage means what? The silkworm will emerge out from the seeds, from the shells, and later next it enters to the next process, that is nothing but the larva stage. And this larva stage, it feed up the many leaves of the mulberry leaves, and later there is one process will be there, eggs laid by the silkworm, and this is the larva, and later there is one process is there, and that process is known as cocoon stage is there. It enters this silkworm enters the cocoon stage. Cocoon where the larva, it made by the larva, it is a protective covering, outer covering of the silkworm. Inside this silk cocoon, silkworm will be there. And afterwards, when it when it collects the silk from this cocoon, and later it will enters into the new stage, that is one adult stage. Like that, this process will be takes place. Adult is nothing but it will completely grown up, and later it will ready to lay once again the eggs. Like that, this process will be takes place, and this process is known as sericulture. This process is also known as life cycle of a silkworm. It is a cyclic process of silkworm. Sericulture means nothing but the rearing of, means what? Sakod. Rearing of silkworm to obtain silk. For obtaining silk, we reared the silkworm. And this process will be like that. The silkworm lays hundreds of eggs on the mulberry leaves. See, one plant is there, and that plant name is a mulberry plant, and where mulberry leaves is there. And these mulberry leaves, these hundreds of or more than thousands of eggs, hundreds of eggs are laid by the silkworm in this leaf. And this leaf contains hundreds of eggs, and this enters to the another stage known as larva stage, where these eggs will be broken up, or emerges this silkworm comes out, and later it will feed up, so that the size of this larva will become more or enlarge one. And then this larva enters to the cocoon stage, where the silkworm made this cocoon. It is a protective covering. Inside this protective covering, that is the cocoon, silkworm will be there. And when completely it is covered or filled up with this silk fiber, then it enters to the adult stage. Then it is completely grown up, and it will form a silk fiber, like a silkworm will be appear, and later the process will be continue. Like this, we can collect the silk from the silkworm, and that process is known as sericulture. This one we call it as life history of silkworm or silk moth. See, sericulture nothing but the process of rearing of silkworm to obtain the silk is called as sericulture. And this is the life history of silkworm, where starting from the this process, the silkworm lays egg, and it enters to the another stage, that one is a larva stage, and then it again enters to the next stage, that is the cocoon stage, and where protective covering is covered with this silkworm. Inside this cocoon, silkworm will be there, and then it enters to the another stage, nothing but the adult stage. And like this, this process will be continuously happen. See, this is how life history of silk moth is there. See, as I told, silk is dragged out from the silkworm. See, lots of silk cloths will be there. Fabrics involves dresses which are made by using the silk, saris, etc. We collect from the silk moth or silkworm, from the silk fiber. See, this is all about the process. See, silkworm. From the silkworm, we collect silk fiber. From the silk fiber, we make into silk yarn, and later silk cloths will be prepared. See, this is how we get silk fiber from the silkworm. Next, we shall move on to the synthetic fabrics. From this is all about the natural fibers, that is from the plant source as well as from the animal source, we get the cloths. And like that, we collect from the plant source as well as from animal source, cotton and jute. These are the example of plant source, and the wool and the silk are the examples of animal source. See, like that we made by using these fibers to make into the cloths. See, these are the natural fibers which are degradable, biodegradable. See, biodegradable means it is easily decomposed. And the synthetic fiber, next we shall move on to the synthetic fiber. As I told, types of fabrics in which natural fabrics is there, and in which natural fabrics, plant source and animal source, we discussed. And the second one is synthetic fabrics. These are the fabrics which are made by the man, or artificially this can be prepared. See, this synthetic fabrics usually prepared by the man, that's why it is called as artificially, by using different types of chemicals. These fibers are strong in nature, strong, and uniformly it is made up of thread will be there, and it is smooth in nature. It is also cheaper than the natural fiber. See, synthetic fibers is nothing but the artificial fiber or man-made fiber. By using different types of chemicals, these fibers are prepared. And this is a strong and uniform in length and smooth in to touch. Like this, the synthetic fibers are made up of, and it is cheaper than the natural fiber. Example of this synthetic fibers are terrylin, rayon, nylon, polyester. These are the examples of synthetic fabrics. First one is terrylin, rayon, nylon, polyester. These are the synthetic fabrics, example of the synthetic fabrics. See, these synthetic fabrics do not have much space in between the these cloth. Space in between this woolen, and that's why it is a uniform in length, and it also do not retain the body temperature. If we wear the synthetic cloth, we feel it is a hot in nature. And this is a non-biodegradable. See, non-biodegradable means what? It not decomposed. Means what? Kolitu hogala. See, non-biodegradable, it never decompose into useful one. Like in the natural fibers, like cotton, jute, and animal fibers include wool and silk, which can easily decompose. Whereas these synthetic fabrics is non-biodegradable, do not decompose. It is as it is, it is there because since various types of chemicals are using, by using these various types of chemicals, this can be prepared. That is nothing but synthetic fabrics. See, this is all about the synthetic fabrics. See, synthetic fabrics is also called as man-made fabrics or artificial fabrics. Why? Because by using the different types of chemicals, this can be synthetic fabrics can be prepared, and it is strong and uniform in length and smooth to touch. See, and it is cheaper than the natural fabrics because since natural fabrics is very much useful and it is comes only from the nature, whereas this synthetic fabric is prepared by man, so that's why it is cheaper to buy. And example of these synthetic fabrics are terrylin, rayon, polyester. These are some examples. and do not have space in between them. Like that, the wool having the lot of space in between them, and that's why it is called as fluffy in nature. Whereas the synthetic cloth, it doesn't have much space in between them. And it is a non-biodegradable. Non-biodegradable, nothing but the decompose. It do not decompose. Kolto hogala. See, natural fibers are natural fabrics biodegradable. Whereas this synthetic fabrics are non-biodegradable. See, this is all about the synthetic fabrics. Next, we shall move on to the blended fabrics. First one is natural fabrics, second one is synthetic fabrics, and the third one is blended fabrics. Blended fabrics is made from both the fabrics, that is from the natural source as well as from synthetic source. Natural fiber and synthetic fibers. See, this blended fabrics usually prepared by using the two types of fabrics. That one is natural fabrics and the synthetic fabrics. By using these two fibers, blended fabrics will be prepared. Example of these blended fabrics are terricotta. See, the example of this terricotta is in which both the fibers are used. Here, obtained from artificial fiber, that is kaolin, and cotton, that one is a natural fiber. See, terricotta, it is a type of fabric where two fibers are used. One is natural fibers and another one is synthetic fibers. Natural fibers, kaolin means kaolin and the cotton means cotton. Both the fibers they have used. See, this by using artificial and also natural fibers, the fabrics will become more strong and durable. Durable, nothing but the bulky barodha. See, durable, strong, and uniform in length. And smooth. See, terricotta is obtained from the kaolin, which is a synthetic fabric, and the cotton, which is a natural fiber or natural fabrics we have obtained. From these two, we can prepare the terricotta, nothing but the blended fabrics, which are strong, durable, uniform in length, and smooth in nature. And also, it is easy to maintain. Easy to maintain. See, this is all about the blended fabrics. See, blended fabrics is a natural or made from the natural fibers as well as from the artificial or synthetic fibers. And these example of these blended fabrics are terricotta, which is obtained from the artificial one, that one artificial fiber, that one is kaolin, and the cotton, which is a natural fiber. And by using this artificial and the natural fibers, the fabrics will become the more stronger and the durable and uniform in length and smooth and easy to maintain. See, this is all about the terricotta. It is a type of blended fabric. So last one is finishing of fabrics. Finishing of fabrics will take place by using the different types of chemicals or dyes they have used, so that the fabrics will prepare. And this is the last process. So this is all about the chapter fibers to fabric. So let us recall the points from the chapter first. See, chapter first, nothing but the fiber to fabric. We learned about the fiber. Fiber comes from the living organisms, like from the plant source and from the animal source. Some of them fibers will be used as a fabrics. Dietary fibers is also there, which is used for human beings, and nothing but the dietary fiber. Some fibers are used for the next process for making the cloths. Next we shall move on to the fiber to yarn by using the spinning process, where this yarn will be twisted to make into the fabric. And then next we learnt about the looms. Looms is a device, and this device is classified into two types. One is hand loom and another one is power loom. See, hand loom is operated by using the hands, whereas the power loom is operated by using the machines. Next one is history of clothing. How from the ancient people, how used or find out the cloth, and later how they will used. And nowadays also we are searching some more devices and some more technologies for preparing different varieties of cloths. And next one is natural fabrics, types of fabrics, in which natural fabrics, synthetic fabrics and the blended fabrics. Natural fabrics which are obtained from the natural fiber, like plant fiber as well as from the animal fiber. Plant fiber includes cotton and the jute. Animal fibers, which includes wool and the silk. See, next one is synthetic fabric. Synthetic fabric, nothing but the artificial fabrics which are made by the man. And these artificial fabrics, by using different types of chemicals, are prepared. Artificial fabrics examples are rayon, terilin, polyester. These are some examples. And there is a less space in between this wool fabrics. And next one is blended fabrics. Blended fabrics, where both the natural fabrics and the artificial fibers or fabrics are used. Example of these blended fabrics is terry cot, using the artificial fabrics as well as the natural fabrics, like terilin and the cotton. See, next one is which are strong, durable. See, terricot is a strong. By using these different types of fabrics in this blended fabrics, it is a strong, uniform and easy to maintain and durable in nature. And this is a non-biodegradable. See, non-biodegradable means what? It do not decompose. And all the natural fabrics are biodegradable, means it can be easily decomposed. Kolto hogodu. See, this is all about your chapter, fibers to fabrics. There are some points which is related to your chapter. I will write on the board now. First one is fiber. Yes, already I discussed about the fiber. We learnt also yarn and ginning, rearing, sericulture. One by one I will write here. Knitting and the weaving. See, first one is fiber. These are the thin, short in length, and which are found in plant as well as from the animal. Thin, short, short in length and found in plants and animals. These are called as fiber. Yarn, next one is yarn. Yarn is a group of fiber which is pressed and twisted to make, and later it will convert it into long thin thread like structure known as yarn. Yarn is also called as thread. Yarn is a group or bunch of fibers which are pressed and twisted to converted into long thin thread like structure. And this is known as yarn. Next process is ginning. See, fiber is nothing but thin, short in length, and usually it is found in plants as well as from the animal. Next one is yarn. Yarn is the group of fibers which are pressed and twisted to make into the long thin thread-like structure is called as yarn. Next one is ginning. Ginning is a process where seeds from the cotton we have to remove. We can remove, and this process is known as ginning. The process of removal of or separating the seeds from the cotton mass is called as ginning. Next one is shearing. It is a process of removal of fleece along with the skin is called as shearing, and this shearing usually takes place in the removal of fleece in animals, wool yielding animals. Next one is sericulture. Sericulture nothing but the process of rearing of silkworm to obtain the silk is called as sericulture. Next one is knitting. See, knitting, the process of making the fabric by using single yarn. See, using single yarn. Whereas weaving, two sets of yarn is made to make the fabric using see, understood the difference between knitting and the weaving. See, in knitting, a single yarn is used to make the fabric is called as knitting, whereas the weaving, the process of arranging the two sets of yarn to make into the fabric is called as weaving. See, two more definitions also there. I will write on the board. See, understood what I am going to teach you? See, fiber is nothing but the thin short found in the plants as well as the animal. And the difference between knitting and the weaving, here in knitting, single yarn is used to make the fabric, whereas the weaving, two sets of yarn to make into the fabric. And this process is known as weaving. And ginning is nothing but the process of removal of seeds from the cotton mass. This is called as ginning. And the shearing is the process of removal of fleece along with the skin of the animal is called as shearing. And see, this is all about. And one more is there, sericulture. Sericulture, the process of rearing of silkworm to obtain the silk is called as sericulture. Next, I will write two more definitions. say thread. Thread is nothing but a tape of yarn. Used for stitching. Next one is loom. Loom is a device for holding the threads in place. Next we shall move on to the fabric. Fabric nothing but the cloth. The materials made by arrangement of yarn. See, one by one we will discuss. Thread is nothing but a type of yarn used for stitching. See, during the process of stitching, a thread is required for stitching. And the loom is divided into two types. One is hand loom and another one is power loom. Hand loom, which is operated by the hand, and the power loom on the basis of machines or power, it will operate it. And the fabric is nothing but the material made by arrangement of yarn. This is the fabric. See, this is all about the important points which is related to our chapter, fiber to fabric. Thank you.